Welcome to the next action point, and that is action point number two. And we are into the series of Key to Change, Raise Responsible Boys. So in the earlier segment, we spoke about recognizing, understanding your own gender biases and then helping your boys to kind of assess and understand their own biases and channelize them. So now today we're going to talk about a very, very important thing because and that is the action point two. And the action point two is actually talking about creating and encouraging to build a positive home environment. That is really crucial. I mean, it's crucial in more than one ways, you know, not just for the gender equality thing or not just for gender mainstreaming, but it is extremely, extremely significant for the mental health of boys, which is often a neglected subject, which is often we just don't think about it. So we are going to talk about what are the ways in which you can create a positive home environment. The COVID or the pandemic has actually given us a lot of statistics and a lot of figures across the world that women especially have been through, women and children have been through a lot of domestic violence, different forms of exploitation. And at the same time, they have also been through a lot of sexual violence and sexual exploitation. And not just this, there have been a lot of instances of online exploitation as well. So when we are talking about building a positive home or building a positive environment in your home where you are raising your boys, it's crucial because boys generally, you know, our culture doesn't allow them to feel their feelings or to speak up or to express. So when they are seeing such things around them, when they're seeing like extreme domestic violence, when they're seeing that their mother is being abused on a constant basis, when they're seeing that their sisters are not being treated equally or in an unfair way, when they're seeing all these things, what happens is they start internalizing these things. They start most of them, it affects them. They kind of do get disturbed, they do get affected. And instead of, not all of them are strong enough to work against it and then, you know, have their own separate belief system, but they start believing that, okay, this is the way you need to treat women. So having a positive home environment where every member of the family is respected, every individual is respected, where the views and opinions of everyone matter, where there is enough scope for free conversations, is what we are talking about. Boys in general love to play outside, and you know, even girls, I mean, see, look at my own gender bias when I just said this and I realize and I'm like, oh no, going back. So children generally like to play out, go out and, you know, interact with people and stuff. So when they are indoors, what happens is they are constantly observing you and they are constantly seeing you and they are constantly monitoring you. And that's happening all subconsciously. On a subconscious level, the kind of interaction that a man and a woman have as husband and wife, as mother and father, affects what the boys think while growing up about women, how they treat women, how they respond to a woman's needs, how they respond to their partners, or what sort of interpersonal relationships they will build with their friends, with their spouses. So a lot depends upon the environment of your home. So your second step or the second action point is that you have to assess what is the climate in your home. What kind of climate do you have in your home? Do you have a home where, once the gender biases are recognized, the second step would be to kind of work towards building a strong, positive, and a conducive environment for the boys and girls. Why am I using the word boys, boys, boys all the while? Because most of the times, girls are always suppressed. Most of the times, yes, they are suppressed. They, even when they are watching the domestic violence, they are kind of continuously, you know, they've been told, no, it's okay, dad did not hit me intentionally, he, you know, so there's a lot of rationalization that happens, and girls start to believe those things. Young girls start believing that, okay, this is the way I'm supposed to be treated, and the boys start believing that, okay, this is the way we need to treat women. So this cycle needs to break, this filthy cycle needs to break. So we need to have a conducive, positive environment. So what are the things that you that can contribute to making a positive home environment? the first and the foremost important thing is language. How do you talk to each other and with each other? Do you bully each other with your language? Because there are homes and there are places I have personally witnessed many of my clients. Plus, while growing up as a child also, I have seen, yes, there are times when there is no respect involved in that language. There are times when, you know, your gender is pointed out and the kind of restrictions, the kind of limitations that are supposed to be there and, you know, that are imposed on the gender is a part of that language. And it is considered to be normal. In fact, that is not normal. That is really abnormal. That is not right. That is totally, totally insane. But if the children are continuously being exposed to a language where there is no respect, where there is no empathy, where there is no compassion, where there is no kindness, where there is no appreciation, definitely that is going to affect the self-esteem of the boys, that is going to affect the self-esteem of the girls in the family, and that is going to affect a lot of dynamics in the future. So it also is very important when I'm talking about language. It always happens that a woman's character is assassinated, and it is completely, you know, anything. Like if she's trying to put one wish or, you know, that she wants to do something, there are families who kind of start questioning her character before her children for no reason. Okay, so when I'm saying language, it's not just about being a gender sensitive language. I'm talking about what the content should be like. So if you are in any way encouraging, or if you are talking like this with your spouses and with your daughters, where you are questioning, you know, their entire sexuality, their identity, their dreams, their aspirations, their needs and necessities, and if the boys are watching it, what do you think they're going to learn? Are they going to learn to kind of come out of it? No, they're not. They are going to learn the same thing, and this same man grows up and then starts believing, okay, this is the way I need to talk to women. And this same man goes to the job, even if he's in the corporate world, he will treat women like that. He will always have a you can say a false assumption about women, that women don't have a brain. They shouldn't be here. They should be in the kitchen. What is this woman doing in this office? And she's trying to be my boss. I will not take orders from her. So you see that the problem does not limit itself only to your home. When you're raising a boy in a negative home environment, especially a boy, when you're raising him in a negative home environment, the consequences, the entire society has to the entire society actually pays for it, I would say. It's a liability. So your language is very important. Your content is very important. There has to be kindness. There has to be compassion. There has to be respect. There has to be dignity. There has to be empathy. There has to be, an overall appreciation for the individual. And you talk to that person thinking that that person is an individual, not that she's a woman. Or, you know, the gender should not matter. What should matter is the individual. You're respecting that individual. So you're respecting not because she's a woman. So I personally believe that when someone says, "Aap aurat hai karke main aapki izzat kar raha hu." So sorry, I just said that in Hindi. So sometimes when we enter a fight, you know, somewhere on a street, like, you know, let's say someone just kind of bumped into me, and I'm like, "What is this? Is this the way to walk?" If I'm like blurting out. So this guy says, "You're a woman, that's why I'm respecting and talking to you. So if you don't keep quiet, now I can just get more difficult." So what does that mean? You're a woman and I'm trying to give you respect. You have to give me respect. You owe me respect because I'm a human being. I'm an individual just like you. So all these are also gender biases that we discussed in action point one. So I want you all to focus on your language. Try to ask yourself, what sort of language do we have at home? How do we talk to each other? Of course, it should be gender sensitive. Of course, it should be all-inclusive. Of course, it should be with a lot of compassion, respect, kindness, empathy, and one should be allowed to have free opinions, and there should be space to express and discuss those opinions. So that is the language. Second important thing to build a positive home environment is giving room for open conversations and difficult conversations. now that is very, very different. So it is not just the lovey-dovey conversations that one needs to have. I think your boys, young boys, especially if you're raising, even in a classroom, in a family, in a workplace, everywhere, we should have scope to have difficult conversations. We should not run away from it. So as a family, you should be able to have difficult conversations together, and there should be a lot of scope and a lot of space for your child, for your son, for your daughter to raise questions. Their curiosity should be encouraged. Whatever happens, you know, they must come and say, "Oh, Dad, I want to talk to you about this. Oh, Mom, I need to talk to you about this." So there has to be the space for difficult conversations, not just conversations. Let's say you and your wife fight. What happens? You just tell the kids, "Okay, go out of the room," and that's it. So maybe, yes, that's a good thing. Okay, you're asking them to go out because you want to discuss something that is personal. But afterwards, if your children come up to you, if your son comes up to you and asks, "Dad, what happened? You asked us to go out. Is there any problem?" I don't want you to say, no, there's no problem. You must be able to say, "Yes, Mom and I are having some issues, but we are talking it out and we're trying to discuss it out." And then you can take it further as much as you want to or you don't want to. But there has to be this space for conversation. Okay, your son has to have this comfort level with you. So when you give space for conversation, it means that you also generate that sort of comfort level for your boys, girls, both of them. I'm stressing more on boys because this campaign is especially for boys. Of course, you can use it for your girls also, and you must use it. So they should be allowed, you know, both the children, girl or boy, they should be allowed to feel comfortable with you as parents, as caretakers, as teachers, as whatever. So they need to feel safe in that conversation space. So you have to create a space for difficult conversations. That space has to be safe. That space has to be open. That space has to be allowing a lot of curiosity. That space also has to have facts, truth to it. It cannot just be that you bluff to your children and lie to them. No, you have to be honest with them, and you also have to give them that comfort level, that ease of conversation. So in this case, what happens is boys generally, what we have observed is they don't like to discuss it much within the family because they've seen their fathers. There's this typical thing that happens, especially in Indian households. I've seen, there's no need to tell everything that happens outside to my wife. There's no need to tell her everything. She doesn't need to know. So the boys kind of pick this mentality up. So whatever they want to do, they do all the shit outside, and they want to mess it up outside. They want to do everything outside, and they will not come and inform you if you do not create the space, if you do not create this conversation space. You have to, you must give them that free leverage and that space to come and communicate to you. They must get habituated, and for that you need to do that often with your life partner. Share your stuff with your life partner. Your children should see that, okay, my parents are working with each other as a team and not against each other or not away from each other. They are together. So that attitude of talking things out. If you have an issue, come and home is the place where you come and sit and talk about it, where you can find solutions, where you can get your support. So it has to be a supportive conversation space. The next thing that you do to have to build a positive home environment is disruption of gender stereotypes. We spoke about the gender biases in the previous action tip, right? Now, this is very important. There are a lot of families, a lot of people, a lot of us, all of us, we associate professions with a particular gender. So I remember when I'd been to my friend's place and her dad was knitting, you know, you knit sweaters and all. So he was knitting. I was so surprised. And I also felt a little uncomfortable that, oh, he's a man. How is he doing this? Of course, this is not so early. I was probably a teenager. And I didn't know that, you know, because in those times we saw dads doing only the outside work, and the household work was supposed to be done by mom only. So that was a difficult time, of course. So disrupt the gender stereotypes. You have understood the gender biases. You've recognized your stereotypes in the previous action tip. So now is the time, if you want to build a positive home environment, disrupt the gender stereotypes. It's fun if your dad is cooking. If you know, as a father, you take up cooking sometime. It's fun if your mother's doing all the plumbing job or the electrical works. So don't try to associate and fix and label things into those gender stereotypes. So disrupt that you can say stereotypes, because stereotypes are not good. They are not healthy. Okay, so no matter what, there can be few exceptions to stereotypes, but most of them, yes, they do not fall into the healthy category. So say no to stereotypes and disrupt the gender roles, disrupt everything, you know. Try to, you can say, it's like, you know, you're used to writing with one dominant hand, like let's say the right hand. So sometimes it's always good to use your left hand also, so that both the brain, both the hemispheres of the brain are working and functioning properly. So for a family to have a positive environment, the gender stereotypes have to be disrupted. So there are many families which don't allow women to drive. They don't allow women to go out and get groceries. I mean, there's an endless list of things I can talk about, you know, in for hours together, about how women are treated and how men kind of dominate the entire sphere. But let's not get into that right now. What I want to say is that I want you to totally disrupt the gender stereotypes at home, especially, and be comfortable with that. No double standards here. Okay, I have seen families where within the family, if it's like just the children and you know, the parents staying together, the father does all the household work and stuff, and the moment there are friends and everyone around, he behaves as if he's the man of the house. I mean, that's how he wants to believe, you know, that I will not do any household chore because my friends will laugh at me. So if your kids are going to see this hypocrisy and this double standard, then the entire purpose is defeated. So be who you are and disrupt the gender stereotypes. Encourage your friends to disrupt the gender stereotypes. If you have a friend who's not helping his wife enough in the kitchen or anywhere else, encourage them to do that, so that, you know, you get a good environment for your kids also once you go out and when you have to socialize. The next point is, I would say the most important point is, you as parents have to be the role model to exhibit gender parity or gender equality. That is very, very significant, because if you fail, the way I said, if you're going to be hypocrites and do something, say something and preach something, the children are not going to take it. So it's very, very important that you be a positive role model. You kind of do everything that is there in your capacity to respect every person in the household and outside also. So that is really, really important. And explain, it also involves that you kind of explain that, you know, women are strong too. Whenever you're seeing your, you know, it's always good to point out, like, look at your mom, she's so strong. Look at your sister, she's so strong. So boys, they learn and they understand, yes, this is strength also. It's not just the number of kgs one can pick up or how many punches one can throw into someone's face, but this is real strength. So you have to demonstrate that by playing that role. So that really matters, because once they see, because kids love to imitate, and they are in awe of their fathers, they are in awe of their mothers, and when they see these people as role models, there's a lot that you're passing on apart from your genes, you know. So you're passing on your stereotypes, you're passing on your belief system, you're passing on a lot of things, you're brushing up on them. So it's very, very important that you should be a positive role model. One quick example I'd like to give is, for younger children, when we tell them stories or when they read stories, allow them to challenge those characters. Once you build strong children with who have a, you know, gender neutral attitude, they kind of start challenging the stories. I have seen that with my kids as well, because you know, when my daughter read the Cinderella thing, she loves fairy tales, but then every time we read a Cinderella or we have a Rapunzel, so when we read it or when we talk about it, when we discuss it at story time also, there are so many questions that this young girl has, and then she says, no, why should I do this, why should Cinderella do this, why should she why is she considered to be whatever XYZ. So then what we do is we twitch those stories and make all these characters more strong, more gender sensitive, more gender friendly, inclusive, including all genders. So that is one thing that parents can do. So young children, young boys, when you tell them these stories, yes, do tell fairy tale stories to your, you can say, sons also. It's not that only daughters need to read fairy tales, but yes, you can twitch them depending on whatever loopholes you see in that fairy tale, and allow a chance for your children to explore that people are beyond their gender. People are human beings, and you need to value the humanity and the humans. Nothing to do with the gender. So you have to treat people with dignity. You have to treat people with a lot of respect. And a lot of positive home environment comes through play as well. So when you're playing, don't try to put your children into those blocks of rigid gender roles. That's where you can disrupt your the entire gender stereotypes by allowing your children to play with different things rather than, I've often heard this term, you know, there are so many girls who like to play with cars, they like to play with guns, they like to play with, Legos or whatever XYZ things that are considered to be, toys for boys. So I've also heard their mothers themselves calling them out saying, oh, she's a tomboy, she doesn't like to wear frocks, she just like to wear, you know, the dresses that boys wear and stuff. So I think as parents, it's time that all of us kind of, peep inside ourselves and see, okay, this, all these things that I've told you, if we don't have a positive home environment, you are influencing a boy to kind of probably, he might turn into someone who is homophobic or into someone who is gender biased and who will not be able to have a healthy, happy life himself because of all these restrictions and all these, beliefs, the stereotypes that he has. So it's important to give a positive home environment to the boys. Let's be positive examples for our own kids. As teachers also, in classrooms also, before I go, I would like to say, I know the videos are getting long because I think there are many people who have not heard discussions on these topics, and it's my earnest attempt to try and tell you that as teachers also in the classrooms, don't differentiate between boys and girls. I remember when I was the monitress, and in my school I used to be the monitress, and we studied in a classroom full of like 70, 75 kids at one time, and then the teachers had this system of checking the books and stuff. So if there was a block of like 70 books, I remember that, the teacher would never allow me to pick the books up because she would say, hey, they're too heavy, you won't be able to do that. And she would have like 2-3 boys deployed to only pick those books up and go behind me and keep them in the staff room or in some other place. So that time we didn't realize all these things. But I think today if my daughter comes and says this to me, I will say, no, that's not true. You can always have different solutions to it. You can say, okay, I don't mind them joining me, but it's not that I'm weak. I can carry the same amount of books that they are carrying, or maybe lesser, but then I can carry a few books to the place, or I can make several trips. So I think that's where you start working. So as teachers, as educators also, try to use gender neutral language, try to be gender sensitive, talk about these things in your class, especially in the grammar class when you're teaching genders. I think that's an awesome time to teach your kids, teach your students about gender equality, gender biases, and everything. So I take your leave, and I hope you like the second action point, that is, build a positive home environment, encourage a positive home environment for the boys, and create the space that you have to. You should be able to use the right language. You should be able to give them a safe space for conversations. You should be able to disrupt the gender stereotypes in your own homes, in your own roles that you play, and you should be able to be the best role model for them, as healthy as you can as a role model, and not be a hypocrite. Thank you, and I will see you in the next tip. Thank you.